So in today's class, we'll start frequency response, which is a prerequisite for your stability and frequency compensation topic in your third unit. We'll start with frequency response. So we'll particularly see the frequency response of a simple CS amplifier. Then we'll learn few concepts on stability, and we'll see the stability of an op-amp and response of an op-amp. So when you discuss about this frequency response of CS amplifier, maybe this circuit is very much familiar to you. Can you draw the frequency response of this circuit, Vin and Vout, with the resistance of RD? What do you mean by frequency response? Gain versus frequency, the variation of gain or the output voltage with respect to frequency. If you plot that, so how will you get the frequency response? What analysis you may need to do in Virtuoso? AC analysis, yeah. So when you do AC analysis and if you plot the gain of the circuit versus frequency, how will be your response? Okay, maybe I'll write gain first. What is gain? Yeah, it is minus gm into RD. So if I plot frequency response, what kind of graph I should get? So as per this, I should get what? Now as per this expression, I should get GmRD. It is a constant. There is no frequency sensitive elements, right? But in a real MOSFET, or when you do this frequency response for a common source amplifier, definitely you will not get this straight line. After some frequency, definitely your gain will fall something like this, right? So you will not get this black line. You will probably will be getting this dotted line. So why so? Your gain expression is GmRD, then why your gain is actually reducing at higher frequency? GM is dependent on? GM is dependent on capacitance. What capacitance? Of the MOSFET. WLCOX, right? If I am not changing the size of a transistor, how it will vary? It should not vary, right? When? Okay. So how it lag? Okay. No, that is correct. So my question is, how this gain expression and this frequency response is matching or not matching? Because of junction capacitor. So whatever gain we have written here, we call this gain as DC gain or low frequency gain. We write this as the gain is DC gain or low frequency gain, which is a gain at lower frequency where the parasitic capacitance of the MOSFET is of no effect. So we know that MOSFET is having several capacitance in the structure. We call it as structural capacitance, or I think you would have studied this. So you will be having a major component called CGS between gate and source. Another component between gate and drain we call it as CGD. Then we have CDB and you have CSB. If your source is grounded, your CSB will be zero. So mainly if you look at the structure of a MOSFET, you can identify these three capacitors, CGD, CGS as well as CDB. And now if you look at the gain expression, we did not account the effect of all these capacitance. Yes or no? So now the gain expression what you have written is low frequency gain or DC gain. And there are no parasitic sensitive elements in the gain expression. That is why you cannot directly plot it. Or if I try to plot the DC gain, it should be a straight line. Now, what is the task? We should obtain the exact transfer function. Now, we'll introduce the term transfer function when it is depending on frequency. So, how should I get the exact expression for the gain or the transfer function of the system? That is by including the effect of all these parasitic capacitors. Is that fine? So, we know that at high frequency, the capacitance CGS, CGD and CDB in this case so these capacitance should be considered, the effect of these capacitance should be considered, and as a result your gain will fall. So here the gain is falling due to these parasitic capacitors CGS, CGD, CDB, etc. So if you remember the frequency response of a common emitter amplifier, like with BJT, if you do, you will get something like this, right? So you have the gain is constant only for a mid frequency range. Your gain is falling at higher frequency as well as lower frequency, right? Why? What is the reason there? In a BJT also you have junction capacitance or parasitic capacitance. That is the reason for falling. The gain falls at higher frequency. What about gain falling at lower frequency? When I draw the response, I should actually refer to a particular circuit diagram. So the circuit which I am using here will be a voltage divider biasing for a BJT, and there I use a three coupling capacitors to couple the signal to the input to take the output and for the stability as well. So those coupling capacitors will act as short, and that is why the gain is actually falling at lower frequency. But in the case of MOSFET, we don't have any coupling capacitors because MOSFET itself is having a very high infinite capacitance at the input, so no need of coupling capacitors in this case, right? So two things we will define by looking at the frequency response of any amplifier circuit. One thing is bandwidth, and generally we define bandwidth as a higher cutoff frequency minus lower cutoff frequency. And if your lower cutoff frequency is very much small compared to your higher cutoff frequency, in this case you can say your lower cutoff frequency is zero, your bandwidth can be approximated as higher cutoff frequency. So ideally we will take at around 3 dB. So this can be marked as my cutoff frequency. So this is one parameter we look into a amplifier by looking at the frequency response. So another figure of merit is, as we call it, as gain bandwidth product. So whenever we design any amplifier circuit, in certain cases gain bandwidth will be given, or in certain cases bandwidth will be given. So these two are two important parameters that we will come to know by looking at the frequency response of an amplifier. So now if you want to study the frequency response of a common source amplifier, so previously we were using this equivalent circuit. What was the equivalent circuit of the MOSFET? So if you look at the ideal MOSFET, this is VGS and this is GMVGS, source, gate, and this is your drain terminal. So this was the model which we used before. Now if your circuit is this, I am considering lambda equal to 0, if your circuit is this with RD and considering lambda equal to 0, to make how will I modify the this equivalent circuit for this particular one? So I'll be connecting input over here, and I'll connect RD over here, and this is my Vout. Right. So from this circuit diagram, or from this expression only, from this equivalent circuit, we will obtain gain as minus GM into RD. But we wanted to know the effect of all the parasitic capacitance. That means I I should not be using this low frequency equivalent circuit. I should use the high frequency equivalent circuit of MOSFET. That means I need to add all the parasitic capacitance into this equivalent circuit. So this is your CGS. This is your CGD, and one more here is your I should actually use the high frequency equivalent circuit of the MOSFET. So this is your high frequency equivalent circuit. From now on, when we consider this frequency response, we will actually, since we are considering the capacitance, we'll actually consider a source resistance also, because we know that there will be some resistance to this input source as well. We will consider the effect of the input resistance also. So actually we are interested to find the gain by including the parasitic sensitive elements here, right? Now, if I want to analyze the circuit, so this should be grounded. If I want to analyze the circuit, is there any problem? Or the analysis will be easy, or? Now, if you look at the equivalent circuit for this common source amplifier, you can see that there is actually a feed-through path, a path from input to output. Our input and output will be interacting through the capacitance CGD, which is actually the capacitance over here, right? So whenever you have a feed through component like that, or whenever you have a component which is existing between input and output apart from their main signal path, how will you analyze such circuits? Will not analyze. Yeah, so how will we analyze? We'll use Miller's theorem. So what is Miller's theorem? Say this voltage is Vx. This is Vy. And this is some impedance Z, and the current flowing here is I. This node is X and this node is Y. That is why I call it as Vx and Vy. It can be. And now your Vx and Vy is related with this relation. Vy is actually A into Vx. That means there is a main signal path through which your signal is actually getting amplified, and the voltage at output point Vy is A times Vx. But in that main signal path, in parallel to the main signal path, you have some impedance path, that is a Z on the top. Right, so whenever you come across this kind of thing, when where there is a main signal path and in parallel to that you have another path through an impedance, you can actually split the impedance that is connecting from input to output, that Z can be splitted. How will you split? So this is my X node. Yeah, that element in the feedback will be replaced as, I'll call this as, say Z1, where the current flow is in this direction. This is I. So the element Z is actually splitted into 2. This is your Y. See the current direction through the impedance in the main circuit, the current direction is from X to Y. So in a similar way, the current direction should be like this. There is actually the current is flowing like this. Right. So instead of the impedance Z, I have a circuit as Z1 and Z2. And what is the relation of Z1 and Z2? Can you just find it? So if you try to find a relation between both, I can write it as Vx minus Vy by Z is equal to Y is in the main circuit and in the second circuit. So this is your relation number 1, and the second circuit Vx by Z1 is equal to I. So if you equate these two, you will get Z1 as Z by 1 minus A. And you will get one more relation here. This I is again equal to minus Vy by Z2. From that you can get Z2 relation, which is Z by 1 minus 1 by A. But you should note that this Miller's theorem is useful when this is useful, or Miller's theorem can be applied when you have an impedance which is in parallel to the main signal path. So we started here, we are looking at a common source amplifier circuit. The normal gain, there is no frequency sensitive elements, but at high frequency we know that gain will reduce, gain will be less. The effect is because of the parasitic capacitance. So from the low frequency equivalent circuit, we have drawn the high frequency equivalent circuit. But there we have seen that the input and output port are interacting through another impedance over there. So whenever you get such impedances, we can solve the circuits using Miller's theorem. And now, tell me what is the impedance seen at the input node. Say you have an amplifier circuit with a gain of minus A and you have a capacitor CF in the feedback path. What is the impedance seen from this side? Or I'll ask, the question is, calculate the input capacitance. So in this case, what is the actual impedance here? The question asked is, what is Z1? Z1, we know that it is Z by 1 minus A. So what is Z in this case? 1 by S into CF. Now what is Z1? 1 by S into CF into 1 minus, your A is actually minus A, so it is 1 plus A. Right, but the question asked is, what is the input capacitance? So what is your Z1? 1 by S into, say, some C1, which is equal to 1 by S into CF into 1 plus A, where C1 is actually your input capacitance, or the capacitance seen at the input side. So that value is equal to CF into 1 plus A. Can you apply Miller's theorem and tell me what will be the input and output resistance? Now if I apply Miller's theorem to this circuit, so input side will be R1 plus R2. What will be on this side? So actually the element here is R1. So at the output side you have R2. Now this R1, the equivalent of R1 is R1 plus R2 on input side, and what is at the output side? Are you getting what we are doing here? You got a minus R2 or R2? Minus R2. So this is Y and you will get a minus R2. So what a circuit is given, which is the impedance in the feedback path R1, right? So I am drawing the equivalent of that R1 by applying Miller's theorem. On X node I will get R1 plus R2, on Y node I will get minus R2. So what is the problem here? Anyway, physical resistance, negative resistance is not a valid one, right? Yeah, so what is the problem here? Whether the problem is with the circuit, or problem is with Miller's theorem, or problem is with us? Huh? Miller's theorem cannot be applied. Why? Correct. That means actually this is the main signal path over here. Your R1 is not actually coming in feedback to the feedback. In parallel to the main signal path, your main signal path itself is R1 and R2. So actually, if I apply Miller's theorem here, I should say this is an improper application of Miller's theorem. I cannot apply Miller's theorem for such circuits. What is A in this case? R2 by R1 plus R2. What is Z in this case? R1. You will get minus R2 only, right? No. Z is not R1 plus R2. Z is R1. X is your input point, Y is your output point. Which is the feedback element here? Or which is the element connecting input and output? It is R1 only. Right.